Welcome to my house. Welcome to the Structure Talk podcast, a production of Structure Tech Home Inspections. My name is Ruben Saltzman. I'm your host alongside building science geek, Tessa Murray. We help home inspectors up their game through education, and we help homeowners to be better stewards of their houses. We've been keeping it real on this podcast since 2019, and we are also the number one home inspection podcast in the world, according to my mom. Welcome back, Tessa. As always, as I say at the beginning of every show, great to see you. We've got a special guest on today. I've been trying to get Doug on our podcast for, I don't know, the last 12 years or so. No, we've only been doing the podcast for five, but I've been wanting to get Doug on this show for quite some time now. Doug is with Dean's Tank, and they specialize in, well, you'll correct me if I get this wrong, Doug, but you guys specialize in basically removing oil tank. Is that it in a nutshell?
In a nutshell, yeah. We specialize in residential petroleum tanks, but we do gas stations. We do all kinds of demolition and for those petroleum tank specific, yes.
Okay. And I'm having you guys on because I'd say probably 95% of what I know about freestanding fuel oil tanks and buried fuel oil tanks comes from you guys. A lot of that came from Dean way back in the day. And Dean, he's no longer with us, right?
No, yeah. Dean passed away about 10 years ago. I'm Doug. I'm his son. He and I started the company back in 1990, and we've been it's been a piece. It's like 34th year.
Wow. Okay.
So, but I am fourth generation oil. So my great granddad was doing boilers, and my granddad, when he got out of World War II, he was delivering fuel oil. My dad started in the he was a dispatcher in an oil company, which transferred to where we're at now.
Okay. All right. Well, you guys have been very helpful over the years with teaching us home inspectors about all things related to fuel oil. I know you guys have shared a ton of photos with me over the years that you've given me permission to use in my blog posts and videos.
Oh, absolutely.
And I've always given you guys credit for it, of course, because you guys are awesome. But I want to use the opportunity to pick your brain about a whole bunch of stuff related to fuel oil tanks.
Sure. Go ahead. Do you want a kind of a baseline of how it works?
Let's start there. I'd love it, please.
Okay. So the history of oil is there was no use out in oil, fuel oil, number two fuel oil, diesel fuel. It's basically all the same things. Diesel fuel or fuel oil didn't really come into use as far as a heating purposes until after World War II. During World War II, we upped our production, the United States upped our production of diesel fuel, and after World War II, we really didn't have a use for it. So it literally, the bottom dropped out. I mean, literally, you could buy it for a penny a gallon. And in a lot of places, you could even get it for free because it was actually a byproduct of gasoline. So when my grandfather, when he got out of World War II, he bought a old chain drive. It was a two-speed chain drive truck, top speed of 18 miles an hour. And he would drive from New Brighton, where he would get the diesel fuel, and he would pump it out for free. He would get the diesel fuel, and he would drive it to either South Minneapolis or Edina, and that's where he would deliver. It was a 500-gallon chain drive, two-speed truck, didn't even have reverse. And that's what he did. So he would do either one or two loads a day, depending on where he was going. If he was going to Minneapolis, or North Minneapolis, he would do two loads a day. If he was going to Edina or South Minneapolis, he'd do one load a day because it would take him forever to get there. But anyway, so in World War II, the price, we had all this diesel on hand. We had all this byproduct on hand, nothing to do with it. But before World War II, everybody was using coal. So if you have a house that is built prior to 1945, chances are your house was heated with coal. And then the thing with coal is that you had to shovel coal into your furnace two times a day. And every other day you had to shovel the ashes out of the furnace. Now you can imagine just the dust and the smoke and everything. That was quite a pain in the butt. But then also you had to store between 5 and 10 tons of coal in your basement. Now, having 5 to 10 tons of flammable material in your basement, not a real good idea. If that ever started on fire, you would never, ever put it out. They couldn't put enough water on the coal to put it out. So when fuel oil came into play, there was a huge, after 1945, it was a huge turnover. People were switching over, whether it was putting in above grounds or underground tanks, where you had to fill the tank one time a year, and it was good. Everything was safe. It was much safer. You could put the fire out. The tanks were safer. If you had an underground tank, you never had to worry about a fire, but you only had to fill it one time a year. Never had to do anything with your furnace ever. Turn the thermostat up and you're good to go. So it was a beautiful thing. And at the time it was amazing. But on the same note, during that timeline, Minneapolis alone lost 30 to 40,000 jobs because there was people that these coal tenders that would actually go to people's houses and shovel the coal in, shovel the ashes out. So 30 to 40,000 people lost their jobs over the wow. transfer of coal to fuel oil.
My grandpa used to do that as a side job when he was younger. I remember him telling me stories about that. He was born in 1918.
Lots of kids got coal lung in Minnesota from doing that, because that's what kids did. It was great sideline work, but we lost a lot of people because of that, because of the coal lung. So it's a very interesting history of all of it. So anyway,
I didn't realize, Doug, that the fuel oil tanks were kind of post like 1940s. You said, I always thought they were 1945. Older than that.
No, before that, and if you did find them, it was very, very rare. And if you did, it was typically a above the grade, system, and very few people had them. So it was very, very rare. After 1945, if you look through the records, all the inspection records and stuff, everything was switched over between 1945 and 1955, and then gas started coming in, especially Minneapolis. The upper echelons of Minneapolis and St. Paul, like along Summit or along Lindale, that's when the first gas lines came in, natural gas lines came in, and then they switched to that. So, I mean, there's some people held out till that, and some people, and that's where we ended up with a lot of abandoned tanks, because back then there was no rules as far as removing the tanks. So the people would switch right from coal to, or from fuel oil to gas, and then there was no rules to take the tanks out. So we end up now with a whole lot of tanks that have been out of service and just been sitting there for 60, 70 years.
What decade did you say that natural gas came into the Twin Cities?
The first pipelines that were put into domestic use would be around 1950 to 1953. The first one ran down Lindale in 1951. And the first one that ran down Summit was 1956.
Wow, that's amazing that you know that.
Doug. I know, that's what I'm thinking. Boy, you know your stuff.
This is 35 years. It's a pretty mundane what I do. I mean, we take a steel container either out from underground or out from a basement, and we run across a lot of, with the permits and stuff like that, we get to look at the permit records, especially Minneapolis. The permit records in Minneapolis are phenomenal. I mean, what you get to see and when things were done, and you see some timelines line up, and then, okay, so when did this actually happen? So, and I've got some great people in Minneapolis that we deal with, so they give me a lot of really great insight information as well.
So what percentage of homes in the Twin Cities decided to switch over to fuel oil? Because I didn't realize it was such a small window between like coal and natural gas that it was kind of available. It seems like most people would have probably just gone right from coal to natural gas then, right?
Yes and no. So number one, just because the pipeline came down Lindale, it only serviced, within a couple blocks of Lindale. So all the main runs, they only got it. So if you look at all the larger mansions and stuff down around 50th and stuff like that, there was a main line that went. That was the first place that pipeline went, is right down the street, and then it went down, and then they serviced all those areas down there around like Minnehaha and that area, as well as Summit. Mm-hmm. They ran Summit, so you got like north and south, two or three blocks, they got gas first. And then like Edina and stuff like that, they didn't get gas for years. I mean, there was a lot of houses that were built in the 60s and 70s that still were on fuel oil because there was no natural gas.
As
things figured out, it took a while for them to kind of work the gas lines in, and then people took their time transferring whether their furnace, they just put a new furnace in. I mean, we still, I literally just yesterday installed a heating oil tank, underground heating oil tank at a residence. So
it's still being done today. Where was that
absolutely.
residence, out of curiosity? How far
I
out
was
did
in
it
Moundsview.
head?
It was in Moundsview, and they actually they just did a upgrade on their furnace, so they have like a $10,000 or $15,000 into their furnace, so they didn't want to switch over to natural gas. And nowadays, I mean, it's insane. The cost of to put a new gas system in, to take a fuel oil system out, put a new gas system in, it's like $22,000, $23,000.
Wow.
So, I mean, for them to put in a replace their old tank, and we do that a lot. I'm replacing the old tanks, taking whether it's an above ground tank or underground tank, we take those out and then install new ones. So
So at a high level, for anyone that's listening, one of the kind of the biggest, most expensive things that you could kind of run into when you're inspecting an older house is potentially a buried fuel oil tank that's abandoned, right?
absolutely. Yep.
And can you explain why that would be a problem, Doug?
Okay, with fuel oil tanks, number one, the fire codes dictates a lot of this. The Minnesota Pollution Control Agency really does not have, in Minnesota, doesn't have, they consider them non-regulated. Residential heating oil tanks are considered non-regulated. So what happens is the fire code gets involved, and they say that any tank that is not in use for, you have 1 year from the time it's taken out of service until you remove it. And it being that it's a fire code, there is no grandfather laws into it. You don't get grandfathered in because of this or because of that. It's you have a flammable liquid storage tank in on your property. After 1 year, it has to be removed. So if it's out 30 years and they find out about it, then and as far as residence goes, it's really not a big deal. With commercial properties, they have then you have a you have to get a I'm trying to think of what the name of it is. You have to get a permit based a residence permit for people to be in the building, and it has to be annually, it's supposed to be annually checked, and they can force you to do it, or they won't update your license to.
Is that a certificate of occupancy?
There
Is
you go.
that?
That's it.
Okay.
That's it. That's exactly what it is. So your
Got it.
certificate, they can withhold your certificate of occupancy if you have a tank that's not in use. And that's a big pusher for especially apartment buildings. Some businesses still have them in. Until we get over above 1,100 gallons, that's where the PCA kicks in, and they can put all kinds of force all kinds of things. Back to your question, as far as how many buildings in Minnesota alone, just in Minnesota, there's a 1 million underground storage tanks.
Well,
1 million
actively still.
actively today. It was at 1.5 million, and over the last 30 years, we've taken about 500,000 out.
Now, whoa, mind blown. Because in my mind, I thought the population of the Twin Cities metro area was around 4 million or something close to that.
Right, but we're talking about the whole state. So I
For the
mean,
whole state.
Duluth
Okay, all
has,
right.
yeah, Duluth has got a big number. But the big number that I try to impose on people, that everything, you're going to work yourself out of business. Not going to happen. I've been doing it for 30 years. We've done about 30,000, right about there. Some years have been bigger,
Wow.
some have been smaller, but we're around 30,000, and there's still 1 million to go. So if I take them all out, I promise I'll be retiring in,
Yeah, you're not
Barbados or
even putting
something.
a dent in this. My
No,
goodness.
no,
Okay. All
no.
right.
Like I
And
said, I'm fourth generation. My son is literally out in the shop right now working on a tank that we're going to install next week.
we're going to be
So
having him on the podcast in a couple more decades here, I
he
think.
wanted to be on today, and I said no.
Oh.
So
Oh, that's great. So, all right, I got so many questions, but
But I mean, back to Tess's question, why does it matter if you've got an abandoned tank besides the fire code? I mean, just
okay, besides the fire code. So practically now, most of these tanks have been out of service for, you know, at least 40 years. So they're just a buried steel container. They're not coated. Some of them have paint on it, but it's pretty rare. So it's just a bare steel container in the ground, and elements are going to take place, whether it's water, whether it's if they're underneath garages where you have salt attacking them, you can imagine what it looks like. I mean, a car that sits out in the air rusts out in just a short amount of time, where you have a buried container, a steel container that has no protection at all, no coating, no galvanization, anything, and they just rot out. Every year it's getting more and more prevalent. And right now I would say we're right about 85 to 90% of all the buried tanks are leaking. So that being said, I mean, it's getting to be a much, much bigger problem. So that's
I didn't realize that. Just sorry to hop in here real quick, that all the tanks that are still in use, people are using fuel oil, like those tanks have a shelf life and they need to be pulled out and replaced after a certain number of years.
Both above and underground tanks, and above ground, all tanks have, they'll get some water in. Buried tanks, obviously you have them outside in the fill pipes and the vent pipes, the water will get inside of them. The downfall of the water is that water is heavier than oil, so it will sink to the bottom of the tank and it cannot evaporate. It is stuck there. It is stuck. So then you have a little drop of water on the bottom of a tank that sits there for 20, 30 years. It's already getting attacked on the outside, but then you have that water on the inside and it literally will rot a hole right through the tank.
So how long will a tank last for? Before it starts to rot out.
The water. The water is the big thing. I mean, that's the one we did, like I said, the one we removed yesterday, that was buried in sand. So it was up in Mounds View. It was up in the Anoka Sand Flat. So it was good, but it was questionable. It was right there at its shelf life. And I congratulated them. I said, you guys picked a great year to do it, because by next year we might have a whole different story. And that can be a whole ball of wax. We get into a leaking tank and you're talking, when the PCA gets involved, it can be very, very expensive. So okay. I mean, not to the point where it's like a dangerous thing. And I always tell people that if you have a leaking tank, it's not, as long as you're not drinking the diesel or fuel oil, or you're not swimming in it, it's not going to hurt you. I mean, the vapors can be annoying, but it's not a dangerous thing. It's not an explosion issue, but it could be very expensive as far as the state goes, as far as cleanups and investigations go.
All right. Now I want to come back to that, but
yes, just real absolutely. Quick, before we should.
I definitely want to dig in, but before we get there, just while we're on the topic of concerns of an abandoned tank, what about an abandoned freestanding tank inside the house? What's the concern there?
So number one, the biggest thing about those things is the fire. So if you do get a fire, and if the fire gets around the tank, you're going to heat the oil up. There's a very, it could be a catastrophic. I mean, it could literally, you're more danger if it's like an eighth of a tank, because then you have all the vapors inside, then the tank fills with vapors. When it does pop, it's going to pop big. Chances are it'll probably blow the foundation out from underneath the house. So, and that's why the fire code is so specific about those tanks, is because when you send your firefighters in and you have a chance, you don't know the tank is there. It could be an extremely danger to the firefighters.
Okay. Now, devil's advocate, how is this any different than if you have a tank that is in use? And we know there's plenty of houses that have tanks in use today. They get them filled regularly.
Right.
How is that not a hazard?
A tank that's full is much less dangerous than a tank that's empty or half empty. Or if, the more airspace you have is the more, because it's not the liquid doesn't explode. It's the vapors that actually do the expansion and the explosion part of it.
Okay.
So all the key takeaway, though, is like if you have a house that you're buying or selling and there's an abandoned tank or buried or freestanding, that's when you have to remove it. But if it's in use, obviously.
If it's in
use,
yeah.
You just have to make sure it's not leaking.
Yeah.
Or rusting.
I always tell people that are buying houses to make sure that's on it. I mean, you buy a house as is with a tank in there, get it taken care of as soon as possible, without a doubt. I mean, people don't realize it. You know, it's behind a bunch of garbage out in the back. Well, that's even more dangerous because, you know, if a fire starts, then all that garbage is going to just ignite everything. So, sometimes people build closets around them, and we've seen a lot of different things with those. And the freestanding tanks they're talking about it's a 265, and you've seen them on the side of the road they're about the size of a cow. I always tell people they're the size of a cow, and they're narrow. They're 26 and a half inches wide. They're 5 feet long and 44 inches top to bottom. It's a 265 gallon tank. And they made them specifically that size so they can fit through doors. So, through a 28 inch doorway. So that's, you know, we pick them up and carry them out all the time. So,
okay. All right.
And that's the freestanding 265 that we're talking about right now.
Okay. So. And what about tanks buried below a house? Have you ever found those?
Yes. During this whole time, the 40s, when they were switching tanks over, a lot of people, their coal furnaces would go out in the middle of winter. Obviously, a boiler's not going to go out in the summer when it's not being used. It's going to go out in the winter. So at that time, when the ground is frozen, you can't bury a tank outside. So the ground is frozen. So they literally have to bury the tank inside underneath the floor. So they would go in and they would saw cut a hole in the floor, dig down, they would put basically like pylons in to hold the dirt from caving in, build the tank in the basement, set it in the hole, and then they would fill the dirt back in and hook it up to the boiler. So then you have a tank underneath the floor of the basement. And it was really cool. Now, here's another part of World War II. A lot of these guys that built tanks were old ship makers. So these guys were metal professionals that would know how to bend metal and then weld it inside. So you'd find these tanks, and I could always tell which ones are made by the shipbuilders because they would weld it on the outside and the inside. So it's double welded on both sides of the tank. If you have just a regular tank builder, they only weld it on the outside. But if you find one that was built by a shipbuilder, he would weld it on the inside as well.
Crazy.
Oh my gosh. So fascinating. Strength.
It's really cool. So anyway, so that's that. So the ones that are underneath the floor are so what we have to do now, we fill them with concrete. We don't remove them anymore because it's too dangerous and too expensive for the simple fact that once we start removing something that large, and typically they're 1,000-gallon tanks, I typically say there's about the size of a minivan, maybe a little bit smaller than a minivan. Okay.
Oh.
And that's buried underneath the floor. So what we have problems with, and we actually had a problem with this back in the early days of my early days, where the inspector made us remove the tank. And then what happened is the dirt caved out from underneath the footings of the house.
Yeah.
And then the house settled and the house literally split. And it was a brick house too. So it was really, really bad. The guy no longer works there. So nowadays what we do is we just saw cut a hole in the floor, we dig down to the top of the tank, we cut a hole in the top of the tank, we pump it all out, get inside of it, clean all the sludge and everything out of it, and then we cut a hole in the bottom of the tank, we take a soil sample from underneath the tank, and that's how we prove that whether the tank was leaking or not, and then we just fill it full of concrete. So it's actually flowable fill, which gets about as hard as chalk. It'll hold the house up, it'll hold everything up around it, but if they ever do decide to tear the house down, they can actually remove the tank still. So
now that's new to me. The last I heard, it was back in the day, you guys would fill them with sand, and then at some point you couldn't do that and you started filling them with foam, I thought. And now you're saying this concrete. Yeah. Do you still use foam?
We don't use foam anymore. The problem with foam is that the foam that's legal to use. It's a non-flammable, and it will fill the tank. Is not set up so that it will stand. So the tank is 5 feet tall. If you put that much foam in it, the foam will actually settle. So then you still have the airspace. You're right back to the same problem, the flammable problem. Not that there's anything in there, but they want that void filled. Plus, the foam doesn't have any structural integrity, so when the tank rots out, it will still collapse. So we got away from foam completely. We've had too many sites where we've went on site and the foam has settled and the tank has collapsed, or the foam has settled and there's an airspace in there, so we have to go back and foam it again. It just got to be not worth the time. And foam used to be very, very cheap. When they were filling, we use the same foam that they fill blocks, like cement blocks. So you have a block building, like Walmart was a big one, where they would fill all the blocks full of foam, and that would be part of the insulation part. But it's kind of that's fell apart, where everybody's using the board now. They put the board insulation against the block instead of filling the block. It's a much more efficient way to do it. So it just got to be, the foam is still a legal way to do it. It's still in the fire code that we can fill them with foam, but there's no way we can guarantee that the foam will stay intact or the tank will stay intact, because it's going to just rust out, rot out, and there's no structural integrity. So we've went completely to concrete now.
Okay. All right. Fascinating. Fascinating.
Yeah. Are most buried tanks about the size of a minivan, Doug, or are there varying sizes?
There's many varying sizes, and it all kind of depends on the size of the house. Typically, I say the 3,000 square foot is kind of our barrier. Anything under 3,000 square foot could be a 500 or 1,000. Anything over that 3,000 is guaranteed to be 1,000. When they installed them, they wanted it only to be able, have to fill the tank one time a year. So the truck would come in anywhere from May until September. They have all summer to deliver all this fuel, and then they were good to go until next year. So if the almost that 3,000 square foot is pretty much a threshold. Anything over that is like I said, it's 1,000, and anything under that could be a 500. And then if you go, once you get up in those 5,000 and 6,000, then there's some houses that have 2,000 gallon tanks, but it's pretty rare.
Okay. All right. Got it. And what about if you've got a buried tank in the yard? And you can get equipment to it. Would you still fill that, or do you just remove those?
No, most of that is dictated by the we call it the jurisdicting official. So it's either a fire marshal or a city inspector who will, and we always put it on them. I don't. If we can remove it, I try to remove every last one of them. If people are buying a house, they want to know that the tank is gone. It's much better. It's much better sales. And then we can take it out. We can inspect the tank. We can look at the hole. We have, you know, all this great information just by, you know, looking at it, and it's gone. It's not on the property anymore. So buyers are much more happy when it's gone. If the only time that we fill them in place, number one, if they're underneath the house, so then it's a structural concern. If it's out in the yard, and typically I will work around one or the other. If there's power over the top of the tank, we'll remove the tank. If we can disconnect the power, or we can just hold the wires out of the way and pull the tank out from underneath it, backfill, that's fine. Or if a gas line, same thing. Sometimes we'll even have the gas company come out. They'll disconnect the gas line, and then we'll remove the tank, put it back. But if I have both of them over the top, if I have gas and electric over the top of the tank at the same time, I won't work with both of them at the same time. When you have an ignition source and an ignition, you know, both, I just don't want to deal with it. It's too dangerous. So then, you know, I usually can talk the inspectors into saying, yeah, we'll fill it in place, and this is why we're going to do it. I mean, if the homeowner wants to do it and they want to pay the money to have everything removed and done, we'll do whatever they want us to do. But for the most part, the structural is the first thing. If it's going to cause structural, even if they build an addition over the top of it where we can't get equipment to it, you know, so the tank was next to the house and then they build like a three-season porch or something. As long as it's hooked to the house or it's a structural concern, we can fill it in place. That's kind of the guidelines of it all. And then anything beyond that. So if we can't get equipment to it, let's just say they surrounded the house with retaining walls where we can't get the equipment up on top, or three-season porches, something along those lines. If we can't get to it, then that would be the other reason. But for the most part, we try very hard to remove every tank, just because it's better that they're gone than have any question marks at all.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. And how would you know that you have a buried tank in your yard?
look at the timelines. I mean, that, if your house was built before 45, you have a very, very, very good chance of that being that it was you have a tank or had a tank.
And even up to the 70s, you said, right? Possibly
70s and 80s. Yeah, it really depends on where propane didn't really kick in until the 80s. I'm going to say propane was about the time when it really got popular, so that people were and the price of it was actually worthwhile that you could still do it. But nowadays propane is so expensive right now, between the delivery cost of propane, the propane tank, fuel oil, still with the price of fuel oil right now, it's still really, as far as BTUs go, you're pretty much getting dollar for dollar the same price for propane right now as fuel oil.
So age was a big identifier. So anything before 1945 up into the 70s, and then and then how else would you identify if there could be a buried fuel oil tank?
Look, so number one, obviously you have an above ground tank, you should be able to see it. If you have two pipes sticking up in your, or even one, a lot of times it's only one. The big one is it's an inch and a half pipe, and then it has a gooseneck on top of it. So mm-hmm. that would be that's the vent pipe, and that's the breather. A lot of times whether the fill pipe was removed or the fill pipe was buried, whether through landscaping or whatever the case may be, or it could even be buried in the bushes or something. But that vent pipe is almost always right next to the house. It's an inch and a half steel pipe, and it has a gooseneck. And a lot of times they're one piece goosenecks where the rain can't get into it or whatever, but that's the breather pipe for the tank. So when they fill the pipe or fill the tank, the oil goes into the fill pipe and the air comes out the vent pipe, because otherwise it would blow air back at you if you only had a single pipe. And then also while it's in use, then as it's drawing down, it has the capability for the air to get into the tank as well. So that's mm-hmm. that's what the vent pipe is probably. I mean, that's the kiss of, we've said the kiss of death, but that's definitely that's what we look for. If I'm looking for that's the first place I'll go. Okay. In your basement also, if they're around your furnace, there may be a couple of copper tubes sticking up. If there's two copper tubes sticking up, almost 100%. No, it's 100%. If there's two copper tubes sticking up next to your furnace, then you had a buried tank. If it's a single line, you probably had an above ground tank.
Okay. Huh. Okay.
How big are those? What's the diameter of those copper pipes coming up through the floor?
3/8. Either 3/8 or half inch. They're pretty rare, the half inch. In residential, it's almost always 3/8.
Okay.
Yeah. So about a little bigger than a pencil.
Got it.
Yeah. Yeah. And that, the two lines, basically what it did is the one was a supply line that would go to the bottom of the tank, and that would, all the lines go through the top of the tank, by the way. They don't come from the bottom. They go through the top. So the lines would come up, and then one would supply the furnace, and whatever the furnace burns, it would burn, but whatever was residue that it didn't burn, the rest of the oil would go back to the tank. And that actually, they would run them close to together, because when they go outside, if the it would heat the oil before it went back. And when it went back, it would keep the other one from gelling or getting too cold or freezing, so that it wouldn't gel your lines. That was the trick.
Interesting.
Of it.
Okay.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah.
All right. And so if someone sees a couple of pipes out in the yard, and they're like, all right, I'm going to call Dean's tank, have him come out and verify there's a fuel oil tank here. What would you do to verify?
The first thing I would do, open the pipes up. And a lot of times you can open the pipe up and you'll be able to stick a tape into it or stick a stick into it to see if the number one, if there's product, and then we figure out the diameter of the tank. So the tanks come in pretty much two sizes. Either it's a 48 inch or a 64 inch tank. It's the 64 inch tank would be 1,000 gallon or some variant of 1,000 gallon tank. So it'd be 64 by 6 feet or 72, 64 inches by 72 inches or 144 inches would be a 2,000. And then you just keep adding on for bigger tanks. For a 500 or then they sometimes they come in a 1,000 gallon variant as well. It's a 48 inch by 6 feet or 48 by 144 inch tank. That would be 1,000 as well, but that would be the first thing. And then I would do a metal detector and I would determine how long the tank is. And typically I outline the tank so we know, if I do get the job, then I would have to call Gopher One and they would know where the tank was as well. That'd be kind of a point of how that would go. So That's what I do. So when it, and sometimes it gets interesting. I mean, sometimes the tanks, like you said, are underneath the garage or underneath the house, or and we have to, you know, then it just comes down to 30 years of knowledge of how things work and how people were thinking of how things did back then. So,
well, and I got to share something else, and I can't remember if it was you or your dad who shared this tip with me back in the day, but I was like, what kind of tools do you guys use to figure this out? And another tip I got from you guys was just put your ear to one of the pipes and then get a wrench or something and bang on the other pipe. Yep. And it's like you can hear there's this big echo chamber. It's clearly, absolutely. And I thought, absolutely, that is a fantastic tip. And
yeah,
I've been using that one over the years. And it's like,
I tell people that all the time. Yeah, that was my dad's trick. Yeah,
absolutely. That was your dad's trick. Okay.
It was my dad's trick. Yeah, we would do that all the time. We're two people. A lot of times you'd see the real estate agent would come out and they had a hammer, and the guy's like, yeah, the real estate agent said, how do you find a tank? And the real estate agent pulled a hammer out of the back of his car and, here, listen to this, bong, bong, bong. You can hear it. It's pretty funny. And it, even regardless of where the tank is, that's, yeah, it's prevalent. It will work.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that. Okay.
You know, we have not touched on cost at all. And I'm just curious, Doug, like, can you give us a range in cost these days? What it would take to, you know, remove both a freestanding tank, probably the easiest thing, to a buried fuel oil tank that's leaked, that's big.
Okay. With above ground tank. So 265, a single 265 right now, they cost $1,250. This is $1,250. That includes pumping, removal, disposal by state law. So out of the top of the tank, the pipes, the fill and the vent pipe go through the concrete wall, and then they'll be on the outside. By state law, we have to remove those as well. The piping that goes from the tank to where the furnace is or was, we blow that out, seal both ends. So that's $1,250. The permits on that, and that's very, very, from like a NOCA, it's $25. In Minneapolis, it's $250 for a permit. Wow. So so that's added on to the $1,250.
Okay.
Got it.
So underground tanks, with residents, it's very variable. It depends on how big the tank is, how big, what's inside the tank, you know, whether it's oil, water, whether, you know, leaking tanks will take on water. So that there's a cost of that. That water has to go through a process to dispose of that. Access, what kind of equipment we can get to it, how far it is, you know, if we've got to run 200 yards with a Bobcat, what it's under, you know, if there's concrete, if it's asphalt, there's so many variants. Typically right now, I say right now it starts around $2,500. Sight unseen, if somebody calls me, I will tell them it's 3,000. I would rather say it's 3,000 and give them a bill for 2,500 than tell them it's 2,500 and give them a bill for 3,000. So it's people, you know, until I get on site and where I actually get on site and see what I'm up against, and then I can give them a hard bid. So
what if it's been leaking? What if it's been leaking or you have to fill it in place? Does that cost a lot more?
Absolutely. So if we remove a tank, it only costs us about $150 worth of dirt to fill the hole back in. If we fill a tank, just the concrete alone is $1,000. So that alone, yeah. So with residential heating oil tanks, for the most part, you don't have to do any kind of soil sampling. We pull the tank out, we do a visual look at the tank, the inspector will look at the tank if there is an inspection, look at the hole and see if there's any signs of contamination. If there is, then we have to, by licensure, I am required to do a soil sample. I'm licensed by the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency. If I see any signs of contamination, leakage, whatever, by my licensure, I am required to take a soil sample. And then we have it analyzed by a lab to determine, and what we're looking for with heating oil tanks, we're looking for DRO, which is a diesel range organic, which is, we can go down that rabbit hole as well, but that's what we're looking for. So when we abandon a tank in place, we have to take a soil sample because that's the only way we can determine whether the tank was leaking or not. We can't do a visual inspection. Looking at the inside of the tank, we can't tell whether it was leaking or not. So we have to take a soil sample. So that's another $250. The concrete's $1,000. With an abandonment in place, I typically give people a start at 3,500 and go up from there.
Okay.
Okay. That's still not as much as I thought it was going to be, actually.
Well, yeah, we do our best. We do our best. We do more, as far as residentials go, we do more tanks than all the other companies in the state combined, by far. We do this day in and day out. We try to do at least two tanks a day just to try to keep up with it. In the summer when we get later days, and if we can do jobs without inspections, so we're actually working 5, 6, 7, 8 o'clock at night. Sometimes that's what it takes. So,
wow.
But,
so how many crews do you have?
Just one of us. Just
okay.
One.
Okay.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's too specialized, and I've tried to hire people on, and when they see the variance of what we do between above ground tanks, underground tanks, abandonment in place, you're talking about flammabilities, you're talking about explosions, you talk about gas stations, a whole nother ball of wax where we're dealing with multiple tanks and huge tanks. I mean, a small gas station has 10,000 gallon tanks, which to give you an idea, a tanker truck is 6,000 gallons. So a semi tanker truck is 6,000 gallons. And on a gas station, they're 10,000 for an average one. So, I mean, we have massive equipment. We've got lots of stuff going on, and there's just, it's really, really hard. And it's a very small community that we have. So for me to find somebody that has any knowledge, I would actually have to go to my competitors and steal somebody. So that's, wow. Yeah.
You got
to
train them.
It's a very specialized trade that it sounds like, I mean, for four generations, you guys have been doing it.
Absolutely. In 30 years. And I mean, I'm surprised every year by new stuff. So it's a fun, I mean, it's been a fun company to run. We're never bored. There's always something new. We never do anything the same every day.
So Doug, I've been dying to ask you, what's like one of the craziest things that you've ever seen?
Craziest. We had one out in Shorewood, so out by Lake Minnetonka, where the guy had a tank and it started leaking. So instead of removing it, he left it there and buried another tank on top of it. So all he did was run his piping from the one tank into the other one. So when they filled the top one, it would run into the bottom one, and that one was leaking. So, but being that it was, and out there they have clay. So in clay, the clay actually held the oil in place. So it didn't actually run out. So here's a funny thing. So if you're in clay and you dig a hole, you're just digging a bathtub because the water can't really run out, right? So then you put a steel tank in a bathtub and put dirt over the top of it. You know what's going to happen. I mean, it's going to rust. And now it's sitting in water all the time. Anyway, so this guy puts another tank on top of it and then buries that as well. And all he did was hook the piping from one to the other so that he didn't have to redo the piping into the house. So we get there, and he couldn't figure out why it wouldn't burn. He said, all I've got is water. Well, you've got no access. You can't even pull the water out of the other tank. We pumped the top tank out. You're still pumping water. I said, the tank's dry. How can we get it? He said, well, there's another tank underneath it. Said, what do you mean there's another? So we had to dig down. We found the second tank, and we removed the whole works, but it was an absolute disaster. Yeah, he had
Did he personally install the tank, or did he find some irreparable?
No, he did it all himself. No, he was an irreparable contractor. he was the guy with the backhoe. I think what he did is he demoed a house and found he took somebody else's tank out that was buried and then put it in his house. So an absolute disaster. Yeah, it was something else. So
that was
the worst of the worst. I mean, that was, and we couldn't, my dad and I couldn't believe it. We'd never seen anything like that. So, but there is, with residentials, you run into all kinds of people because, you know, whether they could be oil people or they could be, you know, anyway, if you go in St. Paul, especially down, not actually like Summit, but if you're like up by Marshall and stuff like that, you get a lot of people that were working at the foundry and stuff. And these guys were metal fabricators as well. So they'd build their own tanks out of, godforsaken materials. Have. Oh, yeah, it was insane. So they would, you know, when they transferred from coal, they'd just say, well, I'm going to build my own tank. And it was like an M1 Abrams tank because they had things weigh like 900 pounds. And we got to cut them up. You know, 50 pieces to get them out of the basement, you know, the same way he carried them down. So it was insane. Yeah, we run into some residentials are, and I think that's a lot why people stay away from them is because there's so many variants. We get into something and you have to go and look at these things because you never know what you're up against.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. It was such a challenge. You know, one last question, Doug, before we wrap this up. Just curious. So, you know, we're talking about Minnesota and really the Twin Cities specifically. But would you say that this is a kind of a common issue in a lot of other states, too? I know that there's states that are still using, like a lot of states on the East Coast, like they still use fuel oil and they, you know, actively. But are there other locations that are, you know, have switched over to natural gas or, you know, something else and they have these buried fuel oil tanks that need to get removed?
As far as the country goes, Wisconsin is huge as well. Wisconsin, okay. Minnesota, North Dakota, South Dakota, Seattle. I've got a, and I'm not going to call it a sister, but I have friends that own tank companies out in Seattle. New Jersey is huge. And the bad part about New Jersey is that it's all salt swamps and they buried these tanks in salt swamps. And the bad part about the East Coast is they don't have gas. That there is no natural gas over there. They didn't run the pipelines to the East Coast, so they are still actively using heating oil right now, and it costs, and they don't have things like we have what's called the Petro Fund. So if we have a, out of every dollar that we spend in gasoline or petroleum at all in the state of Minnesota, a certain percentage of that goes to a fund that pays for investigation and remediation of leaking tanks or leaking anything, any kind of. So if a tanker tips over in a ditch, there's money that is in the state that pays to do the cleanup and the investigation of that. Out in New Jersey, they don't have that. They don't have anything like that. So it's all on the homeowners. And a lot of these places and the insurance companies right now are pushing this really, really big out east. And the banks are kind of scaring, even to the point where a lot of our financial right now is coming from the East Coast. And now they're on it now with, as far as like the houses with these tanks that are abandoned, they won't even allow the mortgage to go through because they've already ate it out in New Jersey. So now here they're really pushing it hard for us to kind of follow the same guidelines, even though we have a safety net with the Petro Fund that will help out with just if you have a leaking tank. It starts at around $11,000 for the investigation. That's where it starts.
Wow.
So,
okay.
Yeah. And there, like I said, that fund will help and it will pay up to 90% of that $11,000. It's called a limited site investigation. And that pretty much just determines whether that when your tank leaked, if it came in contact with the groundwater and then how far it transferred. From there, obviously, like I said before, oil is lighter than water. Once it hits the water table, it spreads out over a very, it's like a drop of gas on a mud puddle. The gas won't mix with the water, but it'll spread out over a very huge area in a very quick amount of time. And they're worried about people with sand points and stuff like that, shallow wells, and you could actually pump that petroleum onto your garden.
Oh, yikes.
Yeah, wow. So that's their biggest concern. It's not very common, but that is their biggest concern.
Yeah.
So there's some help out there for homeowners in Minnesota if they have a tank that's been leaking, unlike other states that don't have a safety net.
Yeah, yeah. I think Minnesota's the only one, actually. Wow. So, yeah, I think that we're
yay, Minnesota!
Yes and no. Yeah, I agree. It's one more. I mean, that's why we pay some of the highest gas prices in the country as well. So, but. It helps out in that way. So, I know way more about this than I admit. So, it's 30 some years of knowledge and I don't, like to I like to learn way more about it. So whether it's through the inspection process or whether it's through permits or just the records of all this stuff, and we find records in the ceilings or in the boiler rooms and stuff all the time. And once you take out the tanks, that people don't want them. So I've got stacks of stuff. So matter of fact, wow. I have this right here. This came out of a basement in St. Paul.
And I'm looking at what looks like a gigantic section of pipe, like a 6-inch pipe with a cap on it. Is that what I'm looking at here?
That's what you're looking at. So this was in a concrete wall. It was sitting like this inside of a concrete wall. And this wall was around an above ground tank. In a commercial properties, the fire code stated that you had to, the tanks had to be protected by either concrete or something, so it would be there was no way that the tank could start on fire or whatever. So they put a concrete block wall around the tank, and then they put sand around it. So this was sitting inside the concrete wall going into the tank area, the tank vault. It's called a vaulted tank. So inside of this, and my son found this, by the way, we found...
So he's unscrewing the cap on this pipe. Yeah. He's taking the cap off. Reaching in the pipe.
And this is an old cash billfold from a bank, and it's the National City Bank of New York. That's what it says on there. I don't know if you can see it.
What a find! Yeah. Oh my goodness!
All right.
Is there anything inside of it?
Oh, it's got cash. Oh my goodness. Wow.
How much money cash was you got that, there? Doug?
Wow. And they're burnt.
Yeah, 1963. So this one's 1963, I think. What was this one? Yeah, 1963. So these back then were probably $100 back then. We figured it out. They're about $1,500 a piece. So you're probably talking about 2 weeks of wages just with these $200 bills.
Wow. Super cool.
Stuck in this, but yeah, that was pretty cool. So yeah, that was, yeah. So that was the one of the few finds that we ever had worth. If you're going to find some, everybody says I'm looking for Jimmy Hoffa.
Of course, of
digging
course.
In people's backyards. Of course, yeah. So that's the coolest thing I ever found. So, wow.
Well, Doug, you are just a wealth of knowledge, and I have learned so much today. It's been really fun having you on. We'll have to have you back.
Yeah,
oh, that'd be cool.
This is amazing. Absolutely. You know your stuff. Thank you so much for making the time to come on here. I'm going to make sure all the inspectors in my company listen to this one. This is,
I do classes as well. So
we need to get you out
for inspection classes. I know you have, I don't think it was, maybe one of your competitors. They have like a monthly meeting where they all get together, have pizza and kind of go through some of the new.
That was us. And,
it was you. Okay.
We hadn't done it for many years since COVID, but we just started doing it again. And after the show here, I'm going to send you an email. We got to get you back out to talk to our guys.
Perfect. We'd love it. Love it. Love it. All right. I whatever I can do to help you guys out. There's always little catches and I can help you out with whatever I can. So you got my number.
And if people want to get a hold of you, how do they reach Dean's Tanks?
My direct number is 763-535-0194. You can call me. That'll go right to my cell phone. I'll answer any question you have or whatever. If I don't know, I know who to talk to. I do have it's deanstank.net is my website.
Okay.
And we're actually in the midst of creating a new one or upgraded one. I don't have a whole lot of time for that side of it, but
how could you?
Yeah, no kidding.
All right, cool. Yeah. Well, thanks again, Doug. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Doug.
Thank you.
All right, you too.
You too.